door with all the high school kids in there, you know, coming
Right, well, that's the reason you couldn't park.
Didn't bother us in the lobby, Father.
It didn't? Oh, yeah. Well, I'm glad it didn't, but it's a little problem we have here every so often. High school thinks they would be...
They should have reserved parking spaces for you.
They should. I think you're right. Why didn't you think of that, Kelly?
I don't know. I'll make one up next time.
I see. I saw one guy, he thought he had the last space in the outside here, in the front, right? And so he goes whipping, I could just see him. And he goes whipping, and he suddenly realized, whoops. It's the spot reserved for the bishop.
Oh.
So, although it doesn't say that on the sign, it just says reserved. Down at the cathedral, we have a sign that says reserved for the bishop. Mm-hmm. So, it's really interesting. People do not believe it. Maybe the staff people that are so often, but that, if you don't have a sign on some.
I know, I was just realizing that. I'm looking around, I'm seeing everyone's beautiful
right,
name.
Well, you can correct that right now.
Sitting nameless. Yeah, I guess I suppose
so. We don't want to embarrass you or anything. That's just in case somebody wants to talk to you.
I encourage that, so.
Right. Somebody might want to say hello, since you're the youngest person here, I think.
Yeah, you look young enough for the Catholic Central orientation, so.
I know, that's what they said when I walked in. They're like, you're here for orientation.
Like, no. Tell them you're the point guard.
I just have 4 or 5 kids.
Nick.
Nick!
So, yeah, it's
halfway legible. That's a good name, all right. So actually, have you all had some scone, or whatever those things are?
Mm-hmm, yes.
Yeah, that's good. I've had some tea. Okay, do you know what high tea is?
Mm-hmm. 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Since you're all so wonderful, tell me what it is.
4 o'clock in the afternoon?
4 o'clock in the afternoon?
It's between your dinner and supper.
It's between your dinner and supper, or it could take you to the place of your supper, actually. For some people, it takes place of their supper. Now, why is that? Because wise Irish people eat a big meal at noontime.
Because of the field work.
In the field, yeah. The old days, they don't anymore. They're like just, they're like us, regrettably. From that point of view, I mean, they're all upside down. But if you go to the farms, they still have the big meal at noontime. And it's a wonderful thing, and the whole setup is amazing. I was over my first trip to Ireland was in 1965, and my mother said to me, I don't know why I'm telling you this story, but anyway, it's an interesting story about how mothers influence their children. My mother says to me, this was a year after I was ordained, right? And my mother said to me, now, when you're going over to Ireland, she says, you take your wool suit. Back in those days, we had black suits, and they were all wool, and heavy, like heavy wool, except during the summer, when you get a reasonable place. So I said, Ma, come on. I've been ordained a year. I really do know the kind of clothes I'm going to wear. That's good, she says, because you'll wear a wool suit. I said, no, Ma, it's the middle of the summer. I'm telling you, wear the wool suit. So after a while, it was easier just to wear the bloody wool suit, getting on the plane, and I figured I'd get over there and, you know, I can get rid of it when I get there, right? I was never so glad in my life that I had a wool suit because the place was freezing. And this was the middle of July. So I was very grateful to my mother. For that one, and telling the stories. The other thing she said to me is, now, when you go to visit the families, because when my dad was one of 18, so we have a lot of family, and then my mother was one of 5. Hardly anybody knows anybody there, but just the crew. And so when you get over there, of course, now you're a priest, right? And so you have to visit everybody. So she said to me, the one thing you do is you do not visit during the middle of the day. This had all been prepared. I would visit, and I had to visit, and there were so many houses I had to get to each day. I only had 10 days while I was there. Right? So might have been 2 weeks left. But anyway, she says, you do not visit in the middle of the day. I said, why wouldn't I visit in the middle of the day? What's the difference? Dude, it's a priest. And she says, because in the middle of the day, she said, a farmer, and remember, it's haying time. Haying time means they're bringing the hay in. She says, it's haying time, and if you go to the house, they will feel as though they have to leave the field and come up and visit you. And there's only so many days in July where it won't be raining where they can hay. So I said, okay. So I get over to Ireland, and my aunt's husband, Johnny, and you're thinking to yourself, why don't you call him Uncle John? Well, in our family, you did not call anybody who was not a direct relative by their name. That was my mother's injunction. So it was Aunt Nora and Johnny, although everybody else in my family, all my other cousins, they all called him Uncle Johnny. I'm like, what is this? You know, how come? Anyway, my mother's theory on that was that you never had to explain to a child later on in life that that person was not really their uncle. So don't tell them initially, then you won't have to try and explain it later. So in all our family, we had, I've told you these stories before, stop me, but even if you stop me, I'll keep telling. So my uncle, all my cousins, and there were some 30 odd of us, all called everybody uncle and aunt, right? Except we three, Dennis Caney's children. And we all said, if it was aunt, it was fine. It was Aunt Nellie and Mert. It was Aunt Julia and Dan. It was Aunt Kathleen and Billy. And that was that, right? And so when I got a little older and logic had entered into my mind just a little bit, I said to my mother, well, how come it's Uncle Jimmy and Aunt Bridie? And she says, she's different. I don't think logically, she's different. What? She's different. And the other interesting thing, I was just fascinated by this. My cousins all said Uncle Din and Aunt Hannah, mm-hmm. right? So she was always called Aunt Hannah, but she would never allow us to do that with the other, whatever it was, you know. No, that's not your uncle. He's Mert. Oh, okay. How come he's married to my aunt? On.
Oh, my goodness.
Little tales of being an immigrant kid. I love it when I say that to the Hispanic children. You know, they're about 5 or 10 or whatever it is, and I say, I'm just like you. I'm an immigrant kid. And they look at me like, you know, this old guy is an immigrant kid. I think it's the kid part that gets them. Anyway, so we'll tell you a few stories tonight because there's no fun in getting together in the Irish tradition if you're not telling stories, right? That's really what Irish life is all about. And I will say on that first trip that I made to Ireland, they were still a very agricultural society at that point. And so the first night I was in Ireland, we gathered in my aunt's room. I didn't complete that other story. I'll get back to that. We gathered together in my aunt's living room, okay? And all the doors, I shouldn't say all the doors, but all the doors in Aunt Nora's house were closable. So if you went into the parlor, you closed the door, right? Mm-hmm. If you went into the dining room, you closed the door. If you went up to the bedroom, you closed the door. Every room in the house, you could close it off. And the reason for that was you didn't have central heating. You only had certain rooms that were warm, and the rest of them were all closed off. But anyway, we were in the parlor, and we all sat around in a big circle, like it would be like the perimeter outside. We sat around in a big circle, and then each person that was there, they'd tell a little story here, there, and the other place. And then finally, my aunt liked to say, now it's time for us to tell stories or sing a little song or do something. And then you would go right around the whole room and everybody would do something. You know, they got up and did a jig, whatever it happened to be. And so, big North American that I am, I got up and I sang Galway Bay. That was my uncle's song, my Uncle Jack. Always sang that song when he was with us, right? Mm-hmm. He had died between the time I was ordained and I got to Ireland. Mm-hmm. So the first night I'm in Ireland, the tear flopped in my face. It was a beautiful thing in one sense, but I thought to myself, wonderful, you know. And he had come to my ordination. He and my Aunt Nora came to my ordination, so they're still very special people. Great folk. But I mean, they're all dead at that moment. So, but we had a grand old time with all of them. Anyway, we're supposed to be talking about the path of Celtic prayer. And when I started this, I thought, well, I'll spend most of the evening telling stories in a couple of pages of the book. How many of you have read the book?
I'm halfway through.
You're halfway through. How many of you have read the book? I thought one of the requirements of this book, this course, was to have the book read.
The course?
I was told it's out of print.
Out of print?
Yes. Irene Storm told me this afternoon it's out of print.
Oh, no.
I just bought it last week from Amazon.
Yeah, used from Amazon. It can still be purchased, apparently.
Amazon says it.
Out of print? How could it be out of print?
No, it's not.
Well, I don't know. I got a copy of it. And I also read it so that we could have a decent discussion, as they would say on Ireland. All right. So since none of you have read the book, we'll just go on telling stories.
No, I want to know about it.
You want to know about it?
Yeah, I do.
It's a very good book. Mm-hmm. Actually, it's not so good at all. It's written by, let's see what it says, a person who belongs to Midwestern Baptist Theological Seminary.
Oh,
my gosh. He's a professor of the Beeson Divinity School.
Oh, Calvin.
And he's also the author of more than 40 books, including the best-selling Singer Trilogy. He's a former pastor, and he continues to be a popular speaker and preacher, which gives hope to us all. And his latest works include Preaching, O Shepherd, Where Art Thou? And Conversations with Jesus. Okay? Well, the wonderful thing about the book, I thought about it, was that it's only a few pages. So it's only 170 pages if you read it from cover to cover. So, and I will be honest with you, I read it from cover to cover. So oftentimes I don't do that. But anyway, he has some thoughts about prayer and the fact of what Irish prayer is like it's different from everybody else's. And in some ways it is, and in most ways it isn't. I mean, you know, I'm not a Celtic scholar, I don't pretend to be. My parents are both from Ireland. As I said, I'm an immigrant kid. We went through the whole immigrant process. My parents became citizens of the United States, very proud of that, they were. And we're proud of them for having done that. And I think, as I said the other day, every so often, you know, you get this immigration thing and how terrible immigration is and blah, 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 blah. Okay? I will just say to you, my parents were just one family, right? One couple. They lived together and produced three children. And those three children, between them, have 6 graduate degrees. Not bad.
Not bad.
Right? So the immigrant experience is one really all the time. Right? You just keep on moving all the time. My parents, there was nothing that got in the way of school. Right? And my father used to say to me all the time, stick to the books, kid. I told that story when I was ordained, you know, that the important thing in the house was to stick to the books. Mm-hmm. And so he would say to me all the time, stick to the books, kid. And he would add, because you'll never be any good at anything else. He used to take me out my dad had these huge gardens near our homes and near our home. And he did not think that I was very adept at gardening. The reason being, I wasn't. But that was beside the point. I thought I could pull beans with the best of them, but not fast enough for him. So, stick to the book, kids. Stick to the books, kid. You'll never be any good at anything else. So anyway, so I stuck to the books. And the Paulus brothers maybe stick to them more than anybody else. Anyway, that's the other whole chapter of my life. This is called The Path of Celtic Prayer. And it's an ancient way, he says, to everyday joy. Well, it is, if you can take the time to read the book and get used to it and realize that what we're talking about in talking about Irish prayer is very different from the way we pray, all right? Now, it's only different in a certain way. And it's different because the basic thing about Irish prayer, at least for the saints, okay? Now, you could say the same thing about most of the saints of today, right? You talk about Mother Teresa, you're going to talk about a saintly person who prayed a lot, all right? Now, same thing with the Holy Father. I still remember going into the chapel where the Holy Father was to celebrate Mass, which is an interesting story in and of itself, by the way. When you go to visit the Pope in the morning, you go, usually this was in the days when they had these kind of audiences, which the Holy Father currently does not have anymore. He doesn't believe in that stuff. You know? Nothing special about me, nothing special about you, we're all just Christians together. And but in the days of John Paul II, we still had audiences, and so if you were to have a special audience, and the one I was to go to was a third, what they call a 30, it was a 30-person audience, so it was only 30 people, it was like this room, okay? And he'd come in and he'd go around and say hello to everybody. And so it was very lovely. But anyway, to get there, you had to get there in the morning at 6:30 a.m. All right. So I had arrived the night before with a donor of ours who had given me $650,000. And I asked him one time, I said, John, is there anything I can do for you? He says, I would love to have an audience with the Pope. So here's this Presbyterian gentleman who gave this Catholic priest $650,000 for a television show I was doing. And he wanted to visit the Pope, and I said,
yeah.
You bet. we can make that happen. You know? And we Paulists have a home, we call it a house, in Rome, and we have priests that work there, and they know their way around. They can make things happen. So I get there, let's say it's Tuesday night, I forget. And it's about 9:30, 10 o'clock. And the priest there, who's one of my fellow Paulists, whom I know very, very well, I walk in the door, and he greets me with, "Where the... have you been?" And I said, "What?" You know, I said, "How about saying hello?" And so he says, "Hello, where the?" And I said, "Sean, the plane just landed. It's not, what should I..." Everybody else, he says, gets here at 9 o'clock in the morning. You get here at 9:30 at night. Why is that? And I said, "Because American Airlines flew me here, and their schedule said that I was to get here tonight at 9:30. Here I am." Anyway, another pleasant evening at the Paulist house. So he says to me, "Well, do you want to go or not?" And I said, "Do I want to go to or not to what?" And he says, "I have an audience ticket for you and for that man that's with you." And I said, "I thought we had three." "We have three, because we brought our publicity person with us." So anyway, over we go. So I'm arriving at 9:30, but I get to bed about 10 o'clock, right? I'm 5 hours behind. In Italy, it's six. I'm either six ahead or six behind. I'm just upside down, right? Mm-hmm. And so the next morning, I have to be at gate so-and-so in the Vatican at 6:30 in the morning, right? So that means to get up about maybe five, to get over there by six, to be sure you're in line by 6:30, because if you're not, nothing. Anyway, we get there at 6:30, and I thought, I could swear they said the audience was at 7:15. Why do we have to start at, Mass was at 7:15. Why do we have to start at 6:30? Anyway, we're going through all this, and I find out, you go up to the papal apartment, and to get there, you have to go up this long flight of stairs, and you take that long flight of stairs by going that way, and then that way, and then that way, and then that way. You kept on going this kind of silly
zigzag.
You didn't go straight up the stairs. You just kept on going, burp, burp, burp. And I'm wondering, what is all this? Well, it gets you exactly to the chapel at exactly 7 o'clock.
Oh, my goodness.
They have it that well mapped out. They know. Oh, wow. So I get to the door of this room, right? And the door swings open, and there's a priest standing there who is now the Archbishop of Krakow, cardinal actually. And he looks at me, and he knows that he knows me from somewhere, but he doesn't know from where. I know who he is. He's Shivish, you know. And he was the Pope's secretary. And of course, every time John Paul II came to the United States, he was right beside him. I was doing the media stuff with him, so I knew him. I loved him before, all that stuff. I didn't know him. He's just one more, and I was one more. And he saw me, and I'm sure something went off in his head, right? And so he grabs me, and he says, "Are you Irish?" And I said, "Well, no, I'm an American. I'm Irish and American, but I'm trying to figure out." And he says to me, "Do you speak English?" And I said, "Of course I speak English." And he says, "Get over there." So I walked over there. And I'm standing there, and suddenly another priest pops in. There's four priests, right? And then there's about maybe 10 or 11 other guys, but they're on the other side. And so Monsignor comes up to me, and he says, "Now, you four will concelebrate with the Holy Father." So I said, "Oh, good, yeah, sure. Like I do this all every day, right?" so we go into the chapel, right? And when we get into the chapel, there's John Paul II kneeling down, facing the tabernacle, and absolutely moaning, just moaning, you know. And I thought, holy smack, what's going on there? You know, and he did that for minutes, you know, just this heavy, heavy moaning. Well, that's his prayer, okay? Now you could say, that's Polish prayer. They're always moaning. No, it's not. It's just, I didn't thought about that. You said that. But, I mean, that's just the way John Paul II prayed. That's it, okay? Nothing special, it's just the way he prays. And so if you're going to say, well, this is the way the Irish pray all the time, that's not true, okay? It's just one of those things. By the way, when we had the concelebration, Holy Father's standing there, right? And by that time, I always forget this, that I'm one of the older priests, right? And that carries some privilege with it. So I'm standing right here. Holy Father, me, number three. And then Holy Father, number four. And in the middle of Mass, I'm like, what am I doing here? And we know how to concelebrate. It's universal. You taught how to do it. You know, I'm kind of like, the next thing I see, and I look down, and it's his finger. And I'm like, what am I supposed to do? Oh my God, I'm supposed to be reading. My part of the Mass to consolidate. Anyway, I get out of there. A million other stories, but I get out of there. I go downstairs. I call my brother to tell him that I had just consolidated with the Holy Father. Oh, yeah, right. I said, honest to God, I did. And so he calls one of my friends, right, our friends. We grew up together. Tells them the story. And the next thing you hear is, you will never guess who concelebrated with Johnny Gaines. just depends on, you know, on your point
That's
of view. Funny. Anyway,
That's cute.
The book tells us that the one thing I want you to grab before this is over, okay, is that the Irish are great believers in pilgrimage, all right? They pray, I think the outstanding characteristic of Irish prayers of the saints, all right? I'm not saying this happened with everybody that I've ever known. It certainly doesn't. I wish it were my kind of prayer, but it's not. I mean, I attempt it. I'm not saying that it ever gets there. But the idea is pilgrimage. You are on a pilgrimage to God. And so everything you do, every beautiful thing that you see, because the Irish are really good about the beautiful things, right? And the reason they are is because they see all around them beauty, right? I was in Scotland this past October, right, for 3 days, because I had to go to Ireland, of course. And Scotland is beautiful. I mean, have any of you been to Scotland? Right? beautiful country. Plus, you folks get to travel there. But, you know, it's really, it's just beautiful. And but a very different kind of beauty. We were driving along, and my cousin, Sheila Ganey, my Uncle Jack's daughter, and her husband is a Scot. So he's sitting in the back seat. He doesn't see well. So he's sitting in the back seat, and I'm driving, and I'm sitting in the front seat. Needless to say, Father has to sit in the front seat. So we're driving along to the mountain, right? And as we're driving up, the hills in Scotland are brown, you know? And I said, the hills are all brown. From the back, we hear, they are. Yeah, you know, like, it was a really brilliant statement. You know? They obviously are brown. And I said, why are they brown? And he said, because of the ferns. And I said, I've never seen a brown fern. Well, he says, John, I guess never been to Scotland. Because in the fall,
the ferns turn brown.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've never seen a fern even in the United States anywhere that I can remember. They turn brown. Now, maybe they do. But
yeah.
In your yard? Oh.
Your yard.
Oh.
Come to my yard.
Oh, yeah. So anyway, that was my first illusion, but it was just, you know. But there, it was beautiful, really lovely. Had a beautiful time. And I flew into Ireland and I thought, it is beautiful, but it's not Ireland. It's just a different quality to Ireland altogether. Anyway, I suppose we should find out what's on this, since I went through all this work. All right. Oh, this is me looking out. We'll give you a few shots. But this is the kind of landscape that you see in Ireland quite frequently, all right? A friend of mine, his name is Chuck Shishla. We've been together doing communication work for pretty close to 30 years, 35 years. Anyway, he went with me on this trip, and he's a marvelous photographer. So some of these are not even as good as you can see them. They're better that way. You get a little better. See the clouds?
No.
Huge amounts of clouds. And my definition of a good day in Ireland is it didn't rain enough to keep you away from what you were going to do. Okay. So, and if you get a sunny day, oh my God, that's a wonderful thing. And during the summer, you get a good bit of that. But you can see here, too, this is all sea, right? I'm pretty sure they just had a flood, and all this is all flooded. I don't know if we have the shot here of the cows being stranded or not.
Oh, there
we are. Oh my God, I told her to put in. Kelly, you were supposed to just put in, what do you call it?
Well, I thought I put in a couple
scenes.
People fixtures.
Yeah. Anyway, you can tell these are all Irish. Now, why can you tell they're all Irish? Huh?
They're all smiling?
Well, they're all smiling, that's one
Irish
thing.
Irish eyes are smiling.
But look at the quality of their skin and so on and so forth. This is, all of these are first cousins. These two are first cousins. That's what we call an outlaw. Okay. More first. Well, these are first cousins once removed. Those three, of course, you know me. And then these are all the Fenn crowd. She's an outlaw too, but she's a wonderful woman even so. And this is another outlaw, but the rest of them are all first cousins. So, and that's just the Fenn family. Okay, there's a whole batch of them. They're all over the place. So anyway. See, and the beaches are lovely too. People forget that they have beaches in Ireland because it's seldom, you don't, it's not like us, you know, when we go to the beach and have beach togs. They just, very seldom they have them. I mean, they have bathing suits, but you don't see them wearing them, you know, because it's a little chilly over there. So, and this is the railway station in Howth. Have you ever heard of Howth? Howth is a wonderful section of Dublin. And it's right above Dublin. Very beautiful. The hills up there are just gorgeous. And they overlook what's his name? Oh, the great Irish singer, rock star. What's the rock group?
Bono?
Yeah, Bono lives there underneath those hills that we were on just before that. Okay, so why do we have the book? We'll have more of those slides as we go. He says himself, we want to address the way the Celts related to God. Okay? Notice he doesn't say anything about prayer. He says, how did the Celts relate to God? Okay. One of the priests, by the way, asked me tonight, he says, is it Celts or Celts? He says, because we all know it's Celtics. I said, it's Celts. Okay. All right. And then, and I love this, how these ancient lovers of God, okay? And I think that's very reflective of the Irish mood and the way they pray. I know when I was a child growing up, you know, my mother was, I believe, a great lover of God. So was my dad. You know, a lot of people forget that little piece that the men are can be lovers of God too. But anyway, I love this. All these ancient lovers of God, and they are, the Celts were ancient people, stripped away institutional business, have anything to do with us, and empty religiosity that can separate Christians from Christ. How's that? Huh? Right. So, I think that's the reason he wrote the book, according to himself, you know, so that they knew, or the people knew, some of that wasn't a matter of stripping away institutional business, because they didn't have any institutional business. But they were so involved with the scenery around them and the beauty of that scenery that they were able to keep themselves focused on God. Now, some of that is focus on God because there's nothing else to do other than the work of every day. You know, whether it was in Cork, like around my father's farm, where it was all bog work. Okay, Cork people are often called bog siders. Right. Now, why? Because the land is lousy, and so it's full of peat, and so they use the peat, and you can still see them in Ireland. There's still racks of it out there, and they do their fires by that, the old-fashioned fires. You know, they've not gotten away from that, although they do have central heating, whether people believe it or not. Okay, but the empty religiosity, now what would that be? What would empty religiosity?
Rote prayers.
You know. Rote prayers, yeah, but don't think just about the prayers. Think about the religiosity. What does that mean? When we talk about empty religiosity.
Rules.
Rules, yeah, right.
Putting on airs.
Putting on airs, right, yeah. You know, you remember the pictures you see of cardinals walking down with the ermine capes and all that kind of stuff? You know, that's empty religiosity, okay? We need the cardinals to be walking around like that.
For
like show. Holes in the head. Yeah, it's all show. And I'm somehow privileged. You know? I'm privileged to be a cardinal, and so I can have this cape flowing behind me while the people around me are starving to death. It's wacko stuff. So, but anyway, so it's that empty religiosity that really does separate Christians from Christ. And I think we have a great deal of it in our country. This empty, you know, I don't want to pick on them because I mean they're good people, basically, but, you know, the Crystal Cathedral out in California, which was created by the Protestant churches and now has been taken over by the Catholic churches. Mm-hmm. There's something about that that's just kind of, you know,
offensive.
And instead of moving people toward Christ, it can really separate them, because people will say, what do they need that for? You know? And there's something to that. You know? So, and it's a very fine line. Very fine line. You know? To deal with that. Okay? Now, these are some of the great saints of Ireland. All right? Patrick, I think everybody knows, because we celebrate him. St. Columba, not so much. All right? Columba was a great missionary. All right?
No, he didn't.
He spent his life in the mission fields, and you'll see a great deal of that. See, the pilgrimage, right? They would get into boats, and they would go from Ireland over to Europe. They would go from Ireland over to Scotland. And in doing that, they brought Christianity with them. Okay? And we forget that. We forget that. A lot of the European countries and so on and so forth were converted by Irish missionaries. Right? They went out and they preached the gospel in a way that was manifest in their own lives, and in that way made what they had picked up in, from the Celtic culture, they made that a part of their life with the people of Europe. All right? So, another shot at St. Patrick. Well, these are some of the, these are some of our things. Chuck's shots again. Too bad, we really need that. Yeah. Again, these are all places that you see in Ireland. These were near some of our homes in the, I mean, you know, my uncles and aunts all had homes just like that. Do you believe that? No, I wouldn't if I were you either. So these are the great manors, okay? The lords of Ireland. And some of the lords of Ireland oftentimes were Protestant. I'm not saying this necessarily is. I'm just saying that oftentimes as we grew as an Irish state and we got into the times of the famine, many of the people in Ireland who owned huge homes were indeed English lords who came over to rule Ireland. And and there's a, well, it's not an awful story, but at one time I was in New York. I was part of a television channel, and we had about 52 religions around the table. And they had this wonderful idea. They thought it was a terrific idea that on Super Bowl Sunday, they would have a collection for supers. We would all be S-O-U-P-E-R-S, okay? Supers on Super Bowl Sunday, raising money for the poor. And so what do you think, John? I said, I think it's about the worst idea I've ever heard at this table. And they said, what? What are you talking about? That's a great thing. Super Bowl, S-U-P-E-R, and S-O-U-P-E-R. And I said, do you know what a super means to me? Well, sure, it's a person that drinks soup. I said, no. No, I said, a person who drank soup in Ireland was somebody who was about to capitulate to the king and deny that they were Roman Catholic. Mm-hmm. And then the English said to them, and then we will give you soup. Well, if you're starving to death, you know, what are you going to do? So I said, I don't think it's a good word to be using. And so they heard me and used it anyway. Anyway. Oh, yeah, there we are. This is down in, this is my cousin Sheila. This is my cousin Sheila, who lives in Scotland, and that's her husband. I think you can figure that out.
Does he have a shillelagh?
Huh?
Is that a shillelagh or just a...
No, he just has a walking stick.
Walking stick.
Yeah, he's legally blind, so it's amazing that he can get and do what he does. Mm-hmm. A former doctor, and just amazing man, incredible. They married, she was 50 when she got married. And I went over to do their wedding.
Oh.
So,
oh, cool.
That was great.
That's cool.
But this is down in where St. Kevin lived. Right now it's skipping my mind. But and they have beautiful gardens down there. But this just gives you a little idea of the kind of thing that we have.
Is it Glendalough?
Glendalough, yes. And there's St. Kevin's Tower. Okay. And this is an old cemetery. And as I say, this is where St. Kevin lived and you know, had his monastery and so on and so forth. My brother's name is Kevin. So the last time we were in Ireland together, we had a spare day. So he said, what are we going to do that day? And I said, well, why don't we go down to Glendalough? Oh, why would we do that? I said, well, let's just go down there. So, boom, off we go. We get down there. I said, well, the reason we came down here really, I said, well, Glendalough is gorgeous, just beautiful. And I said, and I want to show you where St. Kevin lived and worked and so on and so forth. So you'd have some idea where your name came from.
Aww.
Okay, so off we go, and we get finished with the tour and do all that kind of stuff. So I said, so what do you think? He says, I think the church ought to spend a little money and fix this place up. all these graves go way, way back, you know.
Yeah.
And they've spent all the money trying to preserve all of this, you know, this ancient stuff. And I had a very interesting experience that day. I went in And I don't know, they were doing something, so I signed my name, right? And I, why I did this, I have no idea. But I put down Very Reverend John Gainey, CSP. And so the woman picks it up and she says, what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a priest. Yes, I know, but what do you do? And I said, well, I'm the rector of a cathedral. Now, Father, she says, I'm sure you could help us with some of our fundraising efforts. In the meantime, I'm trying to figure out how we're going to pay for the cathedral. Oh, it was a funny thing. So anyway, so here we are. The big thing about St. Patrick and all these Irish saints who became famous for their work with the people in their various places is because they were pastors who were in touch with the communities they served. Now, this is an old piece, this is a pastor talking. I understand that. But I got to tell you, I just thought, this guy's one right after my own heart, right? Mm-hmm. Okay? The greatness of Patrick is and of Columba and all the other saints, Kevin, blah, blah, blah. They were pastors who were in touch with the communities that they served. They lived among the unconverted. When Patrick came to Ireland, they were not all Christians. I mean, that's the reason he came to Ireland, right? They were all Druids. Mm-hmm. And they had their own set of religious beliefs. They were they were pagans basically. And because he was able to get in touch with them, he was able to change them into people who loved Jesus. So and he shaped their culture. One of the things that Patrick is famous for is he did not demand that the Irish people turn into Roman Catholics. All right. Now, were they Roman Catholics? Yes, they were, but they were not Roman Catholics, all right? They were not British Catholics, as he had been trained, all right? Instead, he allowed them to maintain many of their customs, but he brought them through those customs into the Christian and Catholic faith, okay? So, my own predilection, if you never remember anything about Patrick, always remember that that was his gift to the Irish people. That he didn't make the Druids not do the things that they did that were not Christian. He just made sure that what they did became in the theme of Christ and the presence of Christ. So you often hear little fables about various things, like the little people, there's always little people. You know, they run around and they get things moving and they help this and they help that. There are no little people. That's beside the point, okay? We were driving down a road one night with my cousin, who you saw at the end of that picture, back away, Ted. And it is pitch black. In Ireland, there are no lights at night, okay? So you're driving down, and the trees oftentimes touch each other, you know, along the road, right? So you're driving through these trees that are overarching, right? It's a cloudy night. There are no lights. It is pitch black. All you can see is the two little lights, you know, going ahead of you on the road. And I said to Ted, do you believe in the little people? And he says to me, now, Father John, he said, I wouldn't say I believe in them. But then again, don't suppose there's any reason that you should say anything against them. I just cracked up. So and that's part of their culture. You know, you go to the Irish people in a lot of ways, and you talk to them, and they will talk to you right back. You know, for example, you walk into a room. Is it yourself now? No, it's my father. We don't talk that way. Is it yourself now? Yeah, of course it is. I mean, but that's. That's their expression, right? I got lost in Dublin one night, swore that I could get from point A to point B. I had done it 7,000 times with my cousins all the time. So they would say, turn left, turn right. I thought, I can drive there by myself. I had a rental car. And so I got lost. But I also needed gas. I had been up in Northern Ireland, and I came out and I was driving to Dublin to go to see my cousins. Anyway. I get lost, and I get to a gas station, and I go in, and I fill the tank, and I go up to the little kiosk, and there's a man inside, you know. And he says, now, how are you? And I said, I'm fine, how are you? I'm good. I says, I'm also a little lost. Ah, she says, you're not lost at all. He said, you're standing right there in front of me. That's just the way they are. It's just amazing to hear them. So, okay. Now, Patrick and Columba shaped their culture because they had the passion of the original apostles. You remember the original apostles moved all over the world, right? I mean, St. Paul, took trips. It's even today. I mean, you look at them and you think, whew, this is amazing, let alone then, right? When the means of transportation was just so awful then, and as opposed to what you do now. St. Paul, Peter, they get out of Jerusalem. Thomas was supposedly went to India. Whether he did or not, we have no idea. But he is supposed to be the apostle to India. What's he doing in India, right? So they had that same push that came to them from Christ, Go forth and make disciples. That's what Jesus said to us. It's in the last parts of the Gospel of Matthew. So, and then there's something beautiful about them and about the Irish, I believe, in their utter dependence on God. All right? I cannot tell you how many times I heard in my house, both from my father and my mother, but mostly from my mother, God willing. Mm-hmm. When I was in the seminary, all right, I started the seminary when I was 17. When I was 23, I would have been in second theology or third theology. And my mother would say to me, if, God willing, you ever get ordained. When I was a deacon, I'm 6 months from ordination. If, God willing, you ever get ordained. About 3 months before ordination, we went around to the invitations, right? And she said to me, when, God willing, you're ordained. I thought, oh my God. I'm obviously going to be ordained. it took me about 3 months before I was ordained, before she finally got around to the when. Okay? So this, they have just an incredible belief and a trust in God. And you'll hear it in their speech. Not so much now, especially among the people my age. It is amazing to me to see that my parents' generation, I'm the next generation, I still think, right? Mm-hmm. But my parents' generation was so deeply, deeply, deeply dedicated to their Catholic faith and to their dependence on God. And the next generation, my generation, has just practically lost all of it. I said to one of my cousins two trips ago, I said, so keep Marianne in prayer. And she said, well, John, I'll send her good thoughts, but I don't too much pray. And I was just halt. I love her. She's a wonderful person. And I just thought, holy smoke, one generation. So, Lorica is a breastplate. Now, the breastplate, that's a breastplate, no question about that. But for the Irish, there's a breastplate that they put on that's impervious to others, but it's a breastplate that they get from God. So it's the strength of God that is their breastplate. And you will hear, Patrick has a breastplate, and you will hear that in in the prayer. It's a breastplate prayer that they use, and it's really a lovely, lovely piece of the way, and as far as I know, it's the only place I've ever encountered that, the breastplate, the Lord be before me, the Lord be behind me, the Lord increase me, Patrick's breastplate. All right. My. These are all different. Ah, yes. We're back to, what's his name? That's St. Kevin's Chapel over there, the left one. So there's a little bit of Irish for you. Some people call it Gaelic, I think incorrectly, but I'm not going to get myself killed about it. The language is a Gaelic language, but it is Irish. It is not Gaelic Welsh, it is not Gaelic Scotch, it is Gaelic Irish. Hmm. So I have a number of cousins who are all Irish speakers, and I said one day, so I said, when you're talking Gaelic, I heard that pretty quick. You know, John is Irish. So I said, okay. All right. He talks about Trinity prayer. All right. That the Irish had this ability to say a lot of things that began, God the Father be before me, God the Son be, you know, God the Holy Spirit, you know, and they had a prayer, for example, in the morning, a morning prayer that they would get up, God the Father raise me up, God the Son keep me walking, God the Holy Spirit guide me in the ways that I go. And they would do the same thing at night, you know. So it was always Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We, if you notice, do not do that to a degree, although we do some. When we're doing the prayers of the faithful, you know, during Mass, we oftentimes at the end of it will say that we address the prayer to God, right? And at the end we say, through Christ our Lord, amen. Okay, but the Irish, particularly in the early years of the Irish communities, they always talk God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Okay? Now, where is that made manifest? Where would you think? If you were St. Patrick and you were trying to explain God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Right, the shamrock. So, now, whether Patrick ever used a shamrock or not, we have no idea. But it's one of the myths about Patrick, like so many others. That are like that. You know, there is said that he was preaching one time and he stuck a stick in the ground, right? And he preached so long, some of you might think that I do that every so often, but he preached so long that when they tried to take the stick out, it had grown, what do you call it? So they couldn't move it. Right? So those folks spoke a lot of, they took a lot of time. But anyway, just for examples, This is from okay, this is the prayer of Ash Wednesday. Okay, the collect at the Mass. Almighty ever-living God, look with compassion on our weakness and ensure us your protection by stretching forth the right hand of your mercy. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Okay? That's the same thing. That's Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and God the Father. Now, it's, you know, it's just the way we have it. The Irish started with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. The point is that it's here too, all right? Now, some of these prayers in this missal go back to the 5th and 6th century. We forget that. You know, we think they're just prayers that we picked up along the way, or this is the latest translation of whatever. It is the latest translation of whatever. But these prayers go way, way back. Okay. And they're very, very ancient prayers. And so when they changed them a couple of years ago, a lot of the priests got very upset. And I was like, well, you know, they go back a long way, folks. You know, they're not going to sound exactly the way we talk. You know, they just don't. So, very important among the things that the Irish do is the Trinity Prayer in particular. And this is just a shop along one of the streets in one of the towns. I couldn't be honest with you, couldn't tell you. But you'll see they have Frank's Barbershop. One of the things about Ireland in the 50s, every city in Ireland, regardless of the size of the city, would create what do you call it?
Grottos.
Shrines, grottos, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, this particular one happens to be in Mallow. Okay, it's right down the street from my cousin's home, where I often stay when I'm down, in what we call down in the country. Okay. So lovely piece. Liz's father, Liz is the woman who lives up beyond it, had something to do with that one. I don't know what it was. There. Okay. Another one. This one is the near the Ring of Kerry. Anybody remember the castle? Have any of you been to Ireland?
Yeah.
No, you can't remember that one? It's up in Kerry. And a lovely place to visit. I just can't think of the name of it right now.
Ashford, yeah.
No. That's Liz and I outside. We have to see it's only a slightly rainy day. When I have the umbrella, she's of course well used to it. She doesn't have to pay any attention to it. And so that was a lovely day we had there. Now we're getting over. These are the lines of Kerry, a lot of some of that up in Killarney too. Okay, we talked about the three-leaf clover already. To know God is to talk with him as he is. Okay, not as we want him to be, but as he is. All right? I mean, I think a lot of times now in our time, we have gotten used to the idea, I said a prayer and God didn't give me what I wanted. You know, who on God? Well, hello, that's not God's role, is to give us what we want, right? So, to know God is to talk with him as he is. And here we have the awake prayer. I awake in the name of the Father who made me. I arise in the name of the Son who died for me. I rise to greet the dawn in the name of the Spirit who fills me with life. You want to try that one? Right? In the morning when you get up? Instead of, oh, right? So and it's very much a part of who they are. I mean, it's prayer is a very important thing, and you talk to God as God is. This gives you just a little version of it. Okay? All right, I think we're going to take a little break here so you can get up off your chairs and exercise a little bit. So we'll be back here at, let's say, 10 past 8. All right?
Okay.
Is this helping you at all?
Oh, yeah.
Good luck.
Yeah, thank you.
Another school night.
All right, are we all back?
Almost.
Christian mercy.
Got a balance on the side, it's not sitting there now.
Yeah, we'll be back.
You're back.
Can I have a question?
Oh, we don't allow questions. You think this is a place of learning or something?
There's a book, How Ireland's.
You notice, see, this is one of my verses. You notice she didn't get pushed off at all.
There's a book, How Ireland Saved the World.
Yes. Oh, how the Irish saved civilization.
Right, would you just
wonderful book.
Tell me that story, just in a nutshell, how the monk, what was the challenge for the monks to have to protect the text? I
well,
don't
because they were being destroyed. I think Cahill's point, by the way, if you want to read a good book, well, I can't find my own copy, because otherwise it would have been in here tonight. But Cahill wrote the book, I think his first name is Tom, and it's a history, really, of the times that got to be very tough when the English were about to, you know, descend upon Ireland. And the monks realized this, and so they knew that the only thing that would keep them away from either that or the Visigoths, I don't know which it was, would be to have the books. And so they began to copy the books. And they're marvelous books. The Book of Kells is one of them. And, you know, you almost can't believe it. I mean, for those of you who have never seen the Book of Kells, I mean, it's just like, you know, it's just like, it's breathtaking. Because you think, these guys didn't have anything to work with. It's not like they're running down to the store and buying the latest, you know, red paint. You know, they made the red paint. They made the gold paint. They made all that stuff. And then they very meticulously, you know, took these prayers and put them into the Book of Kells. And it's just, it's amazing. One of my cousins, I did their wedding. I witnessed their wedding in God knows when. But anyway, that was their gift to me. When I was leaving, a copy of the Book of Kells, which doesn't do it any justice, but at least you get the idea. But that is the point is of this book, that if it hadn't been for the Irish monks, civilization would have been just destroyed. And so he would say that that's how the Irish saved civilization.
Okay.
I believe it. Well, I'm slightly prejudiced. There was a column yesterday by David Brooks. I don't know how many of you read the David Brooks column. David is a quite conservative writer. I read him because of that. To me, he's like George Will. You know, he's an intelligent, thoughtful, caring conservative. Right. I don't agree with him, but that's beside the point. And besides that, they can write like a song. And David Brooks particularly, I mean, I'm sitting there going, with the dictionary in one hand and the paper in the other, trying to figure out what is he saying now. But anyway, his column yesterday was called The Benedict Option. And so I read it and I thought, I wonder who he's talking about. Benedict Arnold? Because there's a lot of people betraying lots of things these days.
Benedict.
You know, maybe Benedict Arnold. Maybe it was Benedict the 16th, oh, good Lord, that could not be. You know? It wasn't. It was Saint Benedict. And why? Because when the Roman Empire was collapsing, Benedict began the monastery movement. And this man who wrote the book, The Benedict Option, is saying, we have betrayed the Christian tradition so much that we should give up, because it's all gone. There's nothing we can do about this debate. The sexual morality has gotten so out of hand that we can never get it back. So the thing we should all do is withdraw to the monasteries. I don't think so. Okay. Why not? Why would I say not? Well, you can read it this Sunday in that little column I do. That Gaudium et Spes says that we must be, the church must be able to deal with the world in which we find ourselves. And the world we find ourselves in right now is a world that really is, you know, sexually upside down. But the point is that we still must engage the world, and we must have religious liberty, and we must say hello, give the hand of friendship to the other religions. We cannot walk around as if we're the only religion in the world. Okay, we all with it? Good, I can read it Sunday. All right, but I wouldn't. Is it, you know, basically I think we've already talked about that. Is that so much different from our prayer today? Well, it is in the sense of the quality of Father, Son, Holy Spirit. But we still pray in the Catholic Church in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I illustrated it with that prayer from the collect. Now, is every collect that way? No. No. Although most of them are. But, and it's a little harder to find the Father because he always comes at the end, right? But it's Jesus, then the Holy Spirit, then the Father. Okay. So the order may be different, but what I was trying to say was it's not that much different than what the Celts did today. Whoop. A John T. Carr up near. It's too bad you can't see these. I can see them here on the screen. The colors are just gorgeous. So this was another rainy day. Might have been all the same rainy day that you took the shot. So, but anyway, that's a jaunting car. Okay? And you might say, well, what's the difference between that and any other car? And the answer is, they jaunt on that one.
They bounce. So.
All right. And you have a lot of the ancient churches and then the mountains, you know, above them. And they're not really mountains, they're like hills. You know, if you go to Lake George in New York, you'll find the same kind of hills. You know, it's some kind of a geological situation, I'm sure. The other thing, I'll go back to that one. This is an interesting thing. You see what it says here? It says Khmer. That way. I mean, you're on a road, right? And you see a sign and it says that way. Good. I mean, it's not like, you know, it doesn't tell you a thing. You know? It's that way, and it's 71, whatever N is. I assume it's maybe nautical miles, maybe it's. Okay? And then over here are signs for the area, you know, around it. And again, you know, some of the lakes in Killarney. That's a place up in Mayo. There's a cemetery here that has an incredible number of Gibbons people. You'll find that when you go to Ireland, you'll go into cemeteries and you'll find the names of people in abundance. You know, if they hadn't, you know, you go, for example, into the graveyards in my parents' village. And although my mother used to say, don't call it a village. Okay, what am I going to call it now? There's about 10 houses in there. Anyway, but you'll see the names there. And in our grave, a lot of them are Fitzgerald. Okay, and that's one generation above me. We're Fitzgeralds too. But. So in that particular cemetery, they're all Gibbons. Now, why did I care about Gibbons? We have a priest in our community named Tom Gibbons. So I think I sent him a card from there. So, a rainbow. Oh, you should get up here and see this. It's just gorgeous.
Seriously, you can see the flowers in the foreground.
It really is. This is a beautiful shot. My friend Chuck, he's a great photographer. But he's the best professional amateur I've ever seen. Just amazing. Or amateur professional, whichever way you want to go. But he's not, and although he's won prizes too, so I guess he is kind of a professional. But anyway, the story about the rainbow is, you know, whenever you see the rainbow, it's good luck. So when I was landing in Scotland, there was this huge rainbow. And I got out of the car, but out of the plane. Because I thought it was, you know, maybe it was a plane, not a so I thought maybe the diesel fuel was causing the rainbow. But when I got outside on the tarmac, I realized, oh my gosh, it's really here. So my first moment in Scotland, we had the rainbow all over the place, which means good luck. So even though I had to explain it to my cousin, scripture prayer, all right? Now, the scripture prayer that we're talking about here is very important in the sense that it's very much like Lectio Divina. Do we know what Lectio Divina is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We read the scriptures out loud. We read the scriptures to ourselves. And then we reflect about what that particular scripture means to us. The Irish did the same thing. All right? They would read out loud. All right. And where does that come from? Basically, it comes from the poets. Oh, more of this. Is that bubble? Okay. Yeah. See, I don't know if you can see them that well, but down here there's a village, a little village there. And the rest of it is just boom, beautiful.
So what were they called instead of villages? What did you call them?
Well, we never got around to that.
Oh.
Just don't call it a village. I say, well, it's not a city. I know that, but it's not a village either. Okay. I don't know. We never got around to what it should be called. So, all right. Another one. Same. This is the same area. Needless to say. All right. That's the cathedral in Cork City, and has. That's an old building, all right? And it has the most wonderful refitting to go along with the Second Vatican Council that I think I've ever seen. Because you get this really old cathedral with these big, you know, timbers and all the rest of that stuff. And then right smack in the middle of it is this gorgeous reincarnation, if you want to look at it, in Second Vatican II language. It's beautiful. And when I was there, I had an idea that we could take a tour of the cathedrals in Ireland. So, didn't go anywhere, but we had the idea and we tried to make it happen just to, and this was going to be one of the cathedrals we would do. Okay, that's all, as you can see. And, you know, it's another place. And this is the Irish cross, Celtic cross, we're going to call it. And if you know how to read the symbols, all right, there's a story in there. This one doesn't have much of a story, all right. But if you know how to read those symbols, you would know. Now, when my parents died, my dad died anyway, we got a stone like everybody else gets, and then we put a Celtic cross in the stone itself, okay? And in the middle, right here, all right, we have a spoon crossed over, a paintbrush, and encircled in a wedding band. That's my mother and father. Mm. Mom.
Oh, yeah.
And my father was a painter.
Huh.
So that was there, okay?
Wow.
Up here, we have who's the founder of the Red Cross?
Claire Barton.
No. Nightingale.
Oh,
Florence Nightingale. We have a Nightingale lamp. Okay, because my sister is a nurse. Okay, so that's up here. And right here, above right yo, there is the carver carved an exact replica of my chalice.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And, which is a particular treasure now because somebody stole my chalice when I was in Memphis. So I had no, in my mind, I have recollection. But that's, you know, shows the design. I was amazed that he was able to do that. And then down here, we have a book. And that's my brother, the teacher. So if you know how to read it, you can see the family in our, you know, over here is some game. But if you know that, and every Celtic cross like that, where there is a story, well, that's how it's told. Okay. And then out here it says Alpha, and over there there's the symbol for Omega. So we got God into it too. So Alpha and Omega, and then the symbols here.
Where is that? Where are your parents buried, Father?
In Malden, Massachusetts, where I grew up, where my sister and brother and I grew up. So our home was in Malden, Massachusetts.
Okay.
And I asked my mother after my dad died, and I said, Ma, I said, Daddy is on a bended knee before you, proclaiming his love for you. Mm. And because my parents never told us about their courtship. We could never get a word out of it. Mm-hmm. And so I said, so what did you say when he said, will you marry me? And she said, I asked him if he had a house. I said, Ma, you didn't. I mean, he was on a bended knee. He's got a diamond for you. And you ask him, does he have a house? Why did you do that? And she said, because I wanted to know if he had a house.
That's good.
And I said, well, then what did he do? She says, he went out and bought a house. And she added it and finished it off with, and you're living in it, you fool. So it was the house that we grew up in.
Oh, my.
And it was theirs from the, you know, they, when they were married, they walked into that house.
Oh.
And when they were buried, the two of them were buried. My mother was buried. We had all gone. We sold the house. But for those 43 years,
wow.
It was
wow.
just ours. So anyway, so that's Walden's story. Okay, so anyway, the scriptural prayer is praying aloud to find Christ, okay? So you read the stories of the scriptures in order to be more aware of what was going on. Now, one of the things that brings to mind, of course, is that people had to read the stories, but they would read them out loud, all right? And that all of that comes down to the fact that basically the Druids were great poets, okay? And so Patrick doesn't hammer that down and say, you can't be poets anymore. Poetry is very suspicious, blah, blah, blah. None of that. He'll just encourage the poets. And I still think that maybe the thing I told you about, you know, all of us gathering around and talking to each other or telling a story or reading poetry. We had at my cousin's, another cousin's wedding, in Dublin, there was a man there, and we did that at the wedding. We sat down at one part of the reception, and we had a little commodity. We sat together,
yeah.
And we read poems and sang songs and did all that stuff. And sure enough, there was a man there that they called Harry with the Eyes. And I said, no, what's his last name? John, I don't know. He's Harry with the Eyes. Said, oh, Ruth, this is crazy. So anyway, Harry comes in, you know, and they said, John, this is Harry. And I looked at him and I thought, oh my God, this is Harry with the Eyes. He had the most beautiful eyes for a guy. It was just unbelievable. So, but he was a poet. And so that night at the wedding, he read his poetry and we all sat there and we listened to what was going on. It was a great night. They also tried to throw my cousin into the pool. The boys were a little, what do you call it by that point? A little inebriated. And they were going to throw the bride into the pool, right? And what they do is they all line up kind of in a, how many guys, young guys there were, you know. And they lifted her up. And then they passed her from person. So she just went right down the row. And of course, at the end of the row, there's the pool, right? And they never threw her in the pool. But they disrupted her back quite badly, which I'm sure never done. So anyway, so you pray aloud to find Christ. It's very similar to what we do in Lectio Divina, but the slight difference probably would be the reading it out loud. And why would you read it out loud? Because there's probably only one book.
That's right.
So you read it out loud, everybody can hear it. Although he's talking more about Lectio Divina. We read it out loud ourselves, in order to understand it, right? And it's a little bit like sometimes I say to people, if you're going to do this, if you're going to rehearse, you know, for the reading on Sunday, for example, if you're a reader, you know, practice in front of a mirror. Speak it out loud so people can hear you, you know? And they're, well, what difference does that make? Because people can hear you, right? And you will hear the words, and some of that will help you to do it better, to understand it even better than you might otherwise. Okay? So, and praying it outdoors. Now, why would you go outdoors to pray the scriptures?
To be around the beauty of nature.
Right, yeah. The beauty of nature surrounds, God's creation is surrounding you. So why wouldn't you go out, you know, and read the scriptures? And it's very interesting on retreat oftentimes. at least in our case, often go outside, you know, just to, in, like if I was in California having a retreat, you know, soak up the sun. You know, but it's also the beauty that's around you. And that gives you a sense of what God is like. And so you know who he is, you pray to him, what? As he is, right? Not as we wish he would be, as he is. Okay. So, very important sometimes to get out there and promote God.
That's a great picture.
Yeah. Yeah.
That, you need to make that a postcard.
Actually, believe it or not, we have. I don't think it's that one. It's one of me leaning against this. That's my mother's farm.
Aww.
Okay. And it's all grown over. This is what they call, right down here, this is what they call the boreen, what my mother called the boreen. All right? And I said, Ma, what's a boreen? She said, it's a little road. You know. I said, where would you have the boreen? She said, a little road beside the house. So and this was a lovely shaped, it curved in this way, okay? And it was one of the few around that area. It indicated they had a little bit more money than the Ganey family would have, for example. We used to go through that all the time with my parents. My father would tell the story of coming to the United States. It took him 14 days. He was in steerage. He was sick the entire 14 days. Mm-hmm. And he would tell us this story. And at a certain point, he would say, and I did it, and we would all say, all by myself alone. That's right. You know, you laugh now, but it wasn't funny then, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, and then we would say, what about Mama? You know, what did Mama do? Oh, your mother. He says, your mother was rich, you know. She wasn't rich. He said, she came second class, of course. She was too much better than the rest of us. It was too funny to listen to the two of them. But, and the reason, of course, my mother came second class was, yes, they had a little bit of money, but not very much. And she was a girl, and she was 17.
Mm-hmm.
So I think my grandfather said, you know, at least we can do second class.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we did. But anyway, that's the farm. And there's two fields up here, all right? And then there's the field over. And we were there one time. And my niece was with us, my niece, my nephew, and my niece's husband. And my niece is walking down the field. It's right here. Okay, right about here. She's walking down this field. It's April, right? I had said to them in the morning, put on boots. All right. You think they paid attention to me?
No.
Especially my niece. So she's got these lovely, beautiful, sneaker shoes on, right? White, beautiful.
Okay.
So she's walking down the field, and the muck is all over the place. And I mean, this is muck. This is cow dung. And she screams out when she's about halfway down, will somebody please tell me why we're doing this? And I said, so you can get in touch with your roots. She says, I'm already in touch with them.
That's right.
So, and it was there, and then over here, or right about here, my nephew was standing over here in this area, way in the back, and he comes over to me afterwards. I'm standing on the ruins of my mother's farm, okay? I can see the bricks underneath me. I have been in this house before it was destroyed. And he says to me, you know what? You're wrong. Okay, what am I wrong about? He says, well, you're wrong about two things. He says, one, there's no way that Grandma and Grandpa didn't know each other. Oh, I said, okay, why? He says, because they lived so close. Oh, my mother lived out on the farm in a place called Glen Collins, and my father lived in a little village down, you know, maybe 10 minutes away by car, called Belly Desmond, right? My dad was 9 years older than my mother, okay? My dad was 18 or 19 when he left. Therefore, my mother was maybe 9 or 10. And I said, you're absolutely right, Sean. I mean, I'm sure that your grandfather, my father, was looking at a 9-year-old girl figuring, aha. Give me a break. Get over there. Notice something else. And I said, okay, what is the something else? He said, anybody that knows anything about engineering would know better than to build a house where you say it is. It was over there, I'm sure. He, by the way, is an engineer. I said, Sean, nobody here, you know, living in this house was an engineer, okay? They built the house here because it's beside the river,
right?
Okay? Which would make sense for them. Mm-hmm. No, it's over there. It was a great trip. We had the time. Okay, that's St. Croix. Although, this is my father's kitchen. Yeah. Every time I go back, I can go where my father grew up. I still walk into the kitchen. We sit down and we have tea. And this is my cousin who owns the place. And this is his wife, Marianne. We call her Marianne the Second. The reason for that is because she's a Kerry girl. So, which is all right. I mean, somebody has to have them, but no, it was really interesting. My Aunt Nora's husband, Johnny, used to say to me all the time, he says, you know, he says, if Dan was smart, he says, he'd go across the bridge. We're very close to Kerry in this particular place. He'd go across the bridge to Kerry and get himself a good Kerry woman. That's what he should do. He did.
That's what he did.
And she's terrific. So so we go down there. This is, as I said, this is my dad's, where he grew up, in the same kitchen. I don't know if the stove is the same. It sure looks it. But anyway, and we have tea and we have scone and, you know, and then we go off we go. So. But every time I go to Ireland, I go down there. That's my cousin Liz, and so these, as I say, she's first cousin on the Fehan side, and he's Dan is a Tarrant. His mother, my Aunt Margaret, married Dan Tarrant, and that's his son. So anyway, I didn't think all these would be in here, but okay. You get all the stories. Oh, that's the Gainey grave in Belly Desmond. And that's the church. See how church, the church and the grave are always in Ireland are very close to one another. Usually, I shouldn't say always, but usually. And so you have Mass, and after they finish Mass on Sundays, they come out and they putter around in the cemetery, and then they go to breakfast. Mm-hmm. So, and my nieces and nephews think I'm nuts, because I'm a great devotee of that custom. I think it's wonderful to go and visit the old graves. And so this is my, this is where my grandfather and grandmother are buried, right? This is my cousin Dan. He takes care of this place. And you see, he's down here. Pointing out, but there you can see Patrick Gainey, that's my grandfather, and Liz looking over. So we go out there, and this lovely piece, you'll notice that it doesn't fit. I mean, if you look, right, I mean, there's all kinds of Celtic crosses and so on and so forth, and here in the middle is this angel, right? Mm-hmm. Well, it was the people in the United States that sent it over. I don't know whether they sent it over or they, whatever, but anyway, it stands out, just it's individually, whoa. So, and you notice they have no, you see the grass? They don't really take care of the grass. Although Dan does a good job of taking care of that cemetery. At least that whenever I'm there, it's always beautiful. And, but they don't put grass here, you know, in the grave itself. They leave it all dirt and cement kind of stuff. Or they throw a few stones in it. They love phony flowers. I don't know what that's all about. Anyway. And then down about here, down in the poor section, the Barrys are buried. And not quite the poor section, but the stones are not quite as lovely. So although we've had them, you know, when I go back, if they're bad, I just have them read them. But the same thing. It's my grandfather, my grandmother. And I was amazed that the last time I was there, to find out that I hadn't fond of me before. My grandfather was 77 when he died, and that's an old age, because they died in the 50s, so 1950s. And my uncle's buried with them, and his wife is buried there too. The rest of them all went to the United States, and they're all buried in the States. So anyway, enough of that. All right. Oh yeah, Dolly Desmond. Well, this is the church, yeah, where my parents went to church. I went there after my ordination to celebrate, and that's, I think it was like at 10 o'clock, whatever. And so I'm standing in the sacristy waiting, you know, for the people to arrive. Nobody, the church was totally empty. It was about 3 minutes to 10. I'm like, what's going on here? I thought maybe they told them the Yank was going to say mass. They didn't think it would be real. So it was 3 minutes to 10 and then 2 minutes to 10. And suddenly at 1 minute to 10, there was this just awful clatter. And just, I thought, the church falling apart or what? So I stick my head out the door of the sacristy, and there's people fighting for the back pew. And that's what all the clatter is about. So they stand outside until it's, you know, whatever, 2 minutes to 10, I don't know who sets the signal off or whatever. And then all of a sudden they make this mad dash for the church, and the mad dash is to get the last pew, right? this is unbelievable. And then they would fill up from there, you know? Yeah. And of course, like every Catholic church, amen, nobody in front. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Yep. So, anyway, and so the church, well, the church is beautifully kept. And this was the church that my parents grew up in. They were baptized there, all that kind of stuff. So at my 50th anniversary, I went back. And we had a mass at 3:30 in the afternoon, so we didn't have to go through the 10 o'clock. And I go out, and I don't expect anybody to be there, right? It's just a mass, 3:30. And so there was about 40 people there. And I thought, wow, this is amazing, right? And we went through mass, and it was lovely. They had a violin player, a harp player. Mm. Music was just gorgeous. I thought, wow, this is terrific. So at the end of mass, of course, one of my cousins, the senior cousin, gets up to welcome me, and I don't have to tell what a wonderful man I am, the whole stuff. Too much. And it was my 50th anniversary, and blah, 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 and the applause, and all that stuff. And I get up to say thank you back, right? So I'm bada boom, and I say, wasn't the music lovely? I mean, it's just such gorgeous music. I mean, and I want to thank, you know, the women that were here to do this. It's really terrific. So, boom, finish the mass. Afterwards, we go out to take the pictures, you know, for all the families. And one of my cousins comes up to me and she says, John, did you not know the women doing the playing were your cousins?
Oh!
I said, are you serious? How would I know that? And they were her children.
Oh.
And they were all, I mean, it was just terrific. And then I said to them, I said, look, I want to say mass to honor my parents, you know, in the church where they were baptized. And we'll just have a little, you know, a little get together afterwards, right? If you'd like. Oh, they turned the village upside down. I mean, they had a huge meal. It was beautiful. It was something. And I sat at the table, and the pastor came in of this church. And at a certain point, he says to me, because we were sitting there together, and he says, I think they want you at the head table. And I says, my goodness, I said, I'm sitting here with you. I thought this was the head table. So we stayed there. Yeah. It was great. Where are we here? All right, we're going back to the path of public prayer. Okay. The key to the book, again, is I mentioned before, life is a single, unending prayer. That's what we really have to realize as we do all of these Irish good things. That life really is an unending prayer. And that's the thing that I always got from my own parents. You know, whether that's widespread or not, I have no idea. But it certainly was what is key in our lives. Another grotto. That one, I believe, is in Newmarket. Oh, my goodness. You should not show these pictures anyways. This is mass in one of their homes. One of the great traditions of the Irish is that they have what they call home masses. In the old days, when the English were in charge of Ireland, they would go to various homes, and they would, under much duress, celebrate mass for the village, for the people that would gather in that house. And so they called them station churches. And my father was alive at the time of the station churches and he was the altar boy. So he said, I used to go from house to house with all the stuff we needed. He says, and Father would come behind me, and then we'd have Mass. So, I mean, it's, you know, different world, different world. So it's kind of an imitation of that. That was in my cousins in Mellor. This is his way of saying we don't have that sense of prayer, right? Why? Because we're shut up in that modern monastic cell called the automobile. And the book may be a little outdated because he didn't mention anything about and our slavery to what I call the icon of the phone, right? Yeah. I mean, I can't believe it. I had to say to my staff today, I said, you want to get in touch with me? Get in touch with me. Don't get in touch with my phone. Because I might miss my phone. I'm not one of the people that every time it goes beep, I pick it up. I just don't. Mm-hmm. Okay. Huh? Oh, yes, yeah. Okay. This is a reference to Abraham. You remember last week of the Gospel, last Sunday? We talked about Abram. Okay, go out to a land that I pick yourself up from the place you love, and go to a place that I don't know where yet, but go. All right. So this is the same pretty much here with the evangelization of the Irish peoples, that they went from with that same sense. They didn't know where they were going. They just went. And so some of the saints went to Iona, for example, and founded monasteries there. Columba went off into Europe. Patrick himself came from England into Ireland, but they were always evangelizing. And their point was, faith is never a resting place, okay? You don't rest in your faith. You don't say, I'm secure, I know what's going on, blah, blah, blah. So we have to ask ourselves, do we view this world as our home? And do we know whether or not we are captive both to it and our churchy, materialistic lifestyles? You've noticed that the second time? Yeah, he's a little caught up with that. How can we regain our lost sense of pilgrimage? All right? And I think that's very important if you want to get into the idea of how the Celts did their praying. They were on pilgrimage. So all of their life was a prayer. And was it a conscious prayer? No. Okay? It was a prayer because what they did in the name of God, always. All right? No matter what it was, they were doing this for God. And so they were on pilgrimage, and therefore everything they did was prayer. And not because I'm Irish. I really believe in that. You know, people oftentimes say, no, do you spend X amount of hours a day in prayer? No. I spend an X amount of hours a day working for the Lord. What more do you want? You know, that's my prayer. And I think, even though unconsciously, this is what I was doing, was the pilgrimage prayer of the Irish. And I would urge all of us to think about that. That doesn't mean, if your prayer life is good for you, good, stick with it. But you know, think about the idea of pilgrimage, that you are on pilgrimage, that when you work, that is a pilgrimage to God. It is a prayer to God. Right? You're a teacher. You're on a pilgrimage with those kids. You're teaching them. It is a prayer to God if you put it that way. Right? All right? If you're an engineer, what do you do?
I actually work at Guiding Light with
Okay. Terrific. See? So you would have that sense, I believe, of the pilgrimage. It's a pilgrimage. You know, keep these guys the way they need to be. That's your work. You're doing it every day, right? And all of us, we all have whatever work we do, whatever we do in life, that is our pilgrimage. And it is a prayer to God if we can recognize that God is in all that we do. Now, does it help us if we go out into the country? Amen. It does. Okay? If you're cooped up all the time in the city, you don't see what's out there because it's all mucked up. Yeah. Right? I mean, when we go to Lake George, we have a place in Lake George, the Paulus Fathers have. And when we go up to our islands, we own some islands in the middle of the lake. It's a long story, which I won't tell you. But anyway, we own these islands. You go up there, you lay down at night, you know, and look up. Yeah. just blow your mind. I mean, just, you can't believe there's that many stars in the sky. Mm-hmm. You know, where are they going? Where are they coming from? Mm-hmm. Who knows, mm-hmm. right? And but you've got to get into the, you've got to go where the beauty is. Yeah. And we get caught up in the other beauty of the urban situation, but it really can cramp us in if we don't every so often get out and look for the beauty around us, because in that beauty we find God. God is everywhere, and for the Celts it was very important, and they saw in that beauty the love of God. Their God was always present to them from that sense. So, the God of what's left means basically, how much more of the pilgrimage do I have to go? Right? That's what's left. Right? So, as I journey on, I can pray to the God of what's left, you know, because that's all I have to worry about. I don't have to worry about all that stuff back there. It's the God of what's left. So that's when they speak of that. When the Irish speak of that, when the Celts spoke of that, that's their pilgrimage. Patrick would say that, you know, that all I have to worry about is what's left, and go on from there. So and that's an insight from him about the Irish, and from this book. And I think from that point of view, it's really a very valid thought. Because life is the journey, right? At least here at the cathedral, we are doing a prayerful gathering during Lent that's called what?
The journey.
Yeah. So... And Frank Tiziano, who's the one that put that together, thinks it was his idea. I haven't had a chance to tell him that yet. So, good little Italian fellow that he is. So, anyway, you know, the journey is a very familiar thing in Christian life. You know, Jesus was on a journey to Calvary, all right? We talk about that. But the Irish also had that sense within them that they were on a journey that only ended when you were with God. Right? And I was very fortunate to grow up with Irish parents who believed that, you know, and who said that all the time. You know, I would say to my mother, can we go see, my godmother was her aunt, and my granddad. So I said, are we going to South Boston, which is where she lived? And she would always say, well, God willing, or we'll see, which meant God willing. And I used to think, I don't understand why God gets into this, you know. It's the MTA that's going to get us there, right? I mean, I had the wisdom of a child. And life is the journey. And God's presence in that life is what we pray about and what we pray to. And all we need to be concerned about is the God of what's left, who will be there for us all the time. Amen? Now, a little bit about poetry and prayer. Well, there's a little bit more of that. See, we do have some modern, prayers too, but most of them are along the line of that one there. So, oh, we're all bundled up that day. I think these are the Cliffs of Moher.
Mm.
Yeah. 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 So, oh yeah, sure. Yeah. It's a really gorgeous shot here. Too bad. No, such a nice. More of that crowd. Yeah, this bunch, they did their wedding. These two got married by themselves. And this man, wonderful guy, Padraig Fenn. And Padraig was, at one time, he was an Augustinian studying for the priesthood. He left. He did wonderful things for Ireland. And his wife, a wonderful, wonderful woman, Mairead, and... he's since died of Lou Gehrig's disease, so very, very, very tough. But he did great stuff. One time he said to me, "God," he says, "I admire your sense and your ability to make quick decisions." I said, "Really? What? Why?" "Well, look at the way you just did those cards. You know, postcards.
Yeah.
When I go to a postcard rack, I know, for those of you who have ever received a postcard from me, I don't want to offend you, but okay, I just grab, boom, 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 I just go right down, whatever number it is, right? I grab them right off. Doesn't make one bit of difference to me. He thought it was I was making decisions. I was just pulling cards. So, but anyway, he I love your sense.
That's a decision.
How is the, they have great, oh, this is, more of that. It's too bad you can't see them all. There we are. Now, see what I say? That really helps, right?
Oh, yeah, there.
Yeah. Dublin. That-a-way.
That-a-way.
Kirkpatrick. Do you know the story of Kirkpatrick?
No.
Okay, they say, whether it's true or not, we don't know, but there's a mountain in Mayo, just across the beach from my cousin's place, and that they say Patrick climbed. And so up there they have a little chapel, and the idea is that you will climb the mountain in penance. So you climb the mountain on your knees. Okay? So, I mean, I've seen this done in Our Lady in Bosnia anyway, and I've seen them going up on their knees. I think it's crazy because it hurts your knees, you know. But anyway, they say that that's the thing you do. So it's a place of penance, a place of reconciliation, a place of the old hard, you know, monks, the place of Patrick, who was up there. Probably not. Because he was the bishop of Armagh, you know, getting down to Mayo was no joke. So anyway, whether he was there or not, the point is they call it Kirkpatrick, the Hill of Patrick, right? And the story is told of a man climbing up the stairs, and in front of him was a woman, and she's climbing up too. They're both in penance, and her as she goes up, she had shoes on that were too strong, and so the skirt got caught in her shoes, and she turns around to him behind her, and she says to him, would you lift my dress so that I can move up the next level? And he says, it's for doing that I'm doing this. So anyway. Okay, so that's all these places here in Ireland. And how you would ever figure out how to go there is more than I know. I have driven in Ireland. They won't allow me to drive there anymore. Because once you're over 70 in Ireland, you may not rent an automobile.
Oh, really?
Discrimination.
I think it's discrimination, age discrimination. I said to my cousins, I said, I think we should raise the flag of age discrimination here. And they said, good luck. Now, they do have some other grand things. When you get to be 65, you can take a train anywhere in Ireland for nothing.
Oh.
Yeah. So I'm there paying £50 for whatever.
You have to be a citizen?
Right.
Or?
Oh, yeah.
No.
No, and they have not much mercy on the ones that are older, you know, like myself. I paid the full fare, believe me, every time I go down there. And they are lovely, lovely, lovely spot down there. So, all right. And to understand the Celt, you really have to know the poet. The Druids were all poets, as we've already mentioned. Christians, in the Celtic model, Christians are very close to nature. And you find evidence of the Creator in nature. That's what you praise. You praise God because you see all this beauty. And the overwhelming beauty of nature evokes the praise in poetry. We oftentimes speak of Ireland and we say, she has 40 shades of green, right? And I thought, I was growing up in Boston, I heard that a million times, 40 shades of green. And I'm getting on the plane, one of my cousins says to me, says, now, you, when you get over there, you remember the 40 shades of green? And I said, oh, I'll do that now. And I got over there, and I couldn't believe it. I was just like, huge priest. Mm-hmm. I didn't count them, but they had pretty bloody near 40 shades of green, I'll tell you that. Very, very different. Very beautiful. And it all comes out in poetry, which is what they really love. Eire, you know, is the goddess of Ireland. You didn't know that, did you? Mm-hmm. Oh, the goddess of Ireland, goddess of nature. And if you want to think about this, have any of you seen the Canadian Rockies? Yellowstone National Park?
Yeah.
Folks, you got to start traveling. You know? All right. Anyway, any of the things that you can think of that you have seen that are really gorgeous, how about Gloucester, Massachusetts?
Gloucester.
That was there.
Beautiful. Anyway.
The Catskills.
Right. The Catskills. Okay, that's good. Any place is beautiful, right? I mentioned the Canadian Rockies because I thought I was 15 years old when I first saw them. They are absolutely exquisite, just beautiful. It's just, after a while, you get kind of bored because it's so beautiful. It's just, you know, mind-boggling. So, and what do we say to that? God is great, and we are greatly indeed. Okay, He is great. We are the ones who need God. Okay? So that's pretty much the way it works. These are old ruins in also in Mayo. Okay? And this is out the bedroom window of one of my cousin's homes. Mm. When you wake up in the morning, that's what they see. Mm. So they are, we often kid, you know, that my parents and my father's brothers and sisters and my mother's brothers and sisters came to the United States, you know, to catch the golden rainbow that would lead to a pot of gold, right? Yeah. And the people that stayed in Ireland got the pot of gold. And I would say that kind of, their home is just, it's a gorgeous place. And which they built themselves. Mm-hmm. This is out there, front window.
This is
the flood, and these cows are trapped. They can't get off where they are.
Oh.
They were trapped by the flood, and so Chuck shouted because you won't see that very often. So, all right, more of the beauty of Ireland. Those windows are. Oops, take it back. These windows were created by an Irish artist, and they're probably the most exquisite windows I've ever seen, including the ones that we have in the cathedral. Mm-hmm. I think the windows in the cathedral are really something. Mm-hmm. These just. And he does it all with glass. Well, of course he does it with glass. But it's a different kind of glass than the way we do it. Yeah. Just gorgeous, beautiful.
What's the name of the church?
I can't tell you the name of it, although it is in a place called Newport in Mayo. So, but I can't think of his name either, although I think it's Clark. And, you know, just more shots like that. Oh, yeah, I forgot confession. All right, well, we know what confession is all about, right? The big thing about confession is the fact that we accept the fact that we are sinners, all right? And I think sometimes it's very difficult for people in our society to appreciate and to admit, right? But we do say, bless me, Father, for I have sinned, right? A lot of us do anyway, right? But we don't really ever say, I am a sinner. And we are, and we know that. What kind of confession can there be when we, on Sunday mornings, we say the creed? It's a confession, right? We're saying what we believe, okay? It is also, oftentimes, a story, all right? St. Augustine, St. Patrick, they wrote their confessions, right? It's the story of their lives. And in it, they tell you about various things that they believe, are very, very important, particularly the Confession of St. Augustine, okay? And we have the Sacrament of Reconciliation, right, which we call confession, right? We say oftentimes, we go to confession. Even the children get to know that, even though they're trained in reconciliation. All right? This is the train station
you were right about the artist.
What's that?
Yeah. It's okay. St. Patrick's Church in Newport.
Right. Okay, good.
And Clark is the artist, Harry Clark.
Right.
Not Harry with the eyes.
Not Harry with the eyes. Different crowd. And these are some ancient
arches.
Monastery. And the people still are, it's an active monastery, even though it's very, very ancient. And a lot of these pictures are just from there. Same time there. Ah, yes. That's Mulder. Mm. Yeah, I mean, you have to see this so that you really get the idea what this is like.
Beautiful. Oh, wow.
That's a little different, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, that's one of the problems with using this kind of equipment. It doesn't give you the texture of the bodies. So. There we are. You thought you'd never get to the end, did you?